Beautiful, isn't it? If you remember last time, we created the buttons that allow the LEDs to increase in intensity and decrease in intensity. So since the last video, I went ahead and built another version, this time using the rotary. And the rotary dial gives us a different method of controlling the LEDs. I kind of like it. I'm not restricted to a specific speed of increasing and decreasing intensity. I can actually use this to go faster or slower. I like this. The board that we used is the exact same board we used on the last video. On the last video, we had three buttons, one up, one down, and one reset. And if I flip this board around, you'll see where the buttons went. There's one button there, there's a reset in the middle, and there's the other button over there. Of course, they're not actually on the board. Instead, I put the rotary right in the middle. And that's what you see over here. The circuitry to make it work is almost the same. If you're interested in understanding the difference between the button circuitry and the rotary circuitry, I'll put the link in the previous video or one of the previous videos below in the description so you can go catch up. And if you haven't seen some of the other videos, I'll also put a link for the whole journey. We're on episode 24 today, and there's been a lot of work to get to where we are. So if you're interested, make sure you go back and take a look at the journey. So in addition to actually implementing the rotary controller, we also made a couple of different fixes. And I don't want to get into the details right now, but on the last video, there was some troubles that we got into. And one of those troubles had to do with how these indicator lights were lighting up. And you can see right now they're working perfectly. There's the maximum intensity and there's everything in between. At the lowest intensity, there's no magic going on here. The lights aren't actually off. I just didn't put in the last LED because I was looking at this and I realized when the lights are off, I want the intensity indicator to also be off. Anyways, we fixed it. And one of the ways we fixed it was actually to configure or install these little jumpers. So there's a set of four jumpers here. And essentially all they do is they allow us to determine whether you were using a 4-bit intensity, which gives us 16 shades, 32 shades using a 5-bit intensity, and 6 bits will give us 64. Those four jumpers, if you configure them right, will allow us to set the board on one of those settings. So today we're not going to be looking at the circuit. Today we're going to be looking at this monstrosity over here. If you remember, we created this beast ages ago, and we did it so we actually had something to mount these LEDs on. Now these three LEDs that you see here, these are ancient LEDs. They're not modern in any way, and you can see the beautiful job I did to actually get them attached. Oh, go back to the video if you're interested. I'll link the specific video in here where we created this. Take a look. It was so frustrating to go through this. We also have this MOSFET over here, which is no longer in use. This thing is mounted on a wood block. It's not very practical. We need to move to a more aesthetically pleasing design for our luminaire. So we're going to upgrade our LEDs. And what we're going to be upgrading to is something that's way more modern. Take a look. These are Cree XLamp XT-E LEDs. They're not the latest LEDs out there on the market, but they are far better than what we have going on right now. For the same amount of energy that you put into these things, they're gonna generate a lot more light. LED lighting technology has improved dramatically over the past decade, and so this we'll definitely see a big difference when we use these. Now, they're also a lot smaller, which is nice on one end because you can put them into more creative luminaires and make them more effective in illuminating a space. The downside, though, is that we're going to be hand soldering these. So the fact that they're tiny is going to give us a bit of a challenge. Scrolling down in the datasheet gives us an idea of the dimensions that we're working with. 3.3 millimeters square. These LEDs are tiny. Not only that, but they have three leads to connect to. We have our familiar anode on one side, a cathode on the other, and this mystery strip in the middle. Well, LEDs generate some heat. Not nearly as much as the old incandescents, but they do generate some. And if we don't remove the heat from the LED, we risk premature failure. So here's the printed circuit board design that I've put together for our LEDs. I know it looks a little bit funny, but let me explain what's happening here. This PCB design will accommodate three LEDs. You can kind of see where they'll sit, one in the middle over here, one on the left, and one on the right. We have a common strip right down the middle. That's the heatsink strip. If we go back to the datasheet, you'll see that each LED has this giant heatsink strip right in the middle. And so that's what this is. Those LEDs series will all share the same heatsink, which is okay. The heatsink is not electrically connected to the LEDs. It's just a mechanism to remove the heat. And then we have our anode marked with an A over here and the cathode on the other side for the rightmost LED. It's connected with the lead to the next LED. This LED will have the anode on the bottom and the cathode on the top, which is then connected to this LED. And this one also will be the anode on the top, cathode on the bottom. So essentially we're taking three LEDs and we're putting them together in series for this PCB design. Remember, each LED has a voltage drop of about 3.5 volts, and our controller generates 12 volts, which allows us to put three LEDs in series and have a little bit extra in case of losses. Another thing you'll notice about this design are these two giant holes on the side. These are for screws. We need to be able to mount this PCB onto something. And so I put those screws in place to give us the ability to mount it. The heatsink strip is also connected to those screws. So the screws can also serve as a way to pull the heat away. So perhaps we can mount the screws onto some sort of a metal backing that'll allow us to dissipate more heat. The other thing you may have noticed about the PCB design is that the pads are not the same size. Take a look. If you look at the anode and the cathode for our three LED in series circuit, they are slightly bigger than the rest of the pads. The reason I did this is because I needed a place to solder in the wires to connect this PCB to, well, the driver. The other thing you might notice is that although the LEDs are square, these designs are not. They're a lot more rectangular. I needed that extra space because, as you're going to see in a second, these LEDs do not have any leads to solder. There they are. These are our three LEDs that are roughly 3.5 millimeters square. And you can compare them to the size of the other older LEDs that we have on our block right over here. Let's remove one from the packaging. We'll take a closer look. Look at this tiny little LED. You'll notice that there are no visible leads to solder to, unlike the leads that we had over here. It was really easy to solder these leads together and attach the wires to. This has no leads on the front of it to solder. All the soldering pads are on the back. And when you're soldering this to a PCB, it's impossible to reach those leads on the back directly with the soldering iron. So we're gonna have to get a little creative to solder this to our PCB. And there it is. There is our printed circuit board for our LED, all manufactured, ready for us to use. You'll notice right away that you can see the screw holes on the ends, which allow us to attach this to something. You can also see that strip right down the middle, which is connected to the circles around the screw holes to give us a way to get rid of that heat. And there's also the six pads that will allow us to connect these three LEDs to those pads. And you can see the variation in the sizes of those. It's small. I know, it's gonna be so hard for us to solder this, but that's why I made this video, to show you the challenges in doing this, but it can be done. The other special thing about this PCB is that it was not manufactured using a traditional process. It was manufactured on an aluminum substrate. Whenever you're designing a PCB for LEDs, it's a good idea to use aluminum because we wanna maximize its ability to extract that heat. Now for the fun part, we're gonna solder those LEDs to that printed circuit board. If you've never soldered tiny LEDs before, be prepared to lose a few of them. It's really challenging to do this. I by no means am an expert, and it's interesting. I've seen some videos out there, and there are people who are absolute magicians at this. I am not one of them. So it's going to be a challenge. I might even lose some of the LEDs that we have on hand right now. The tools that I'm gonna be using, of course, are a regular soldering iron. I got one right over here. We have regular solder, which I have over here. And we also have my magic special ingredient, liquid flux. This stuff is amazing. It's kind of dangerous though. Just watch out. There's even a marking on the bottle that says, do not drink. Yeah, no kidding. And I have a small paintbrush that I'm going to use to spread our liquid flux. Let's get started. The first thing I like to do is spread some solder onto that heatsink strip. And that solder will serve as the first anchor point for our LEDs to attach to this PCB. The next thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna use my paintbrush and apply a layer of flux to all of the pads and to that soldered strip, the heatsink that I just did. Cap the flux after you're done with it. You don't wanna spill this. Next, I'm going to solder the first LED. Now, You want to make sure you know which side is the anode and the cathode. And sometimes the easiest way to do that is just to use a multimeter and use the diode test in the LED. And when you connect it the right way from anode to cathode, the LED will light up very dimly to let you know that which way the current flows. Now that you know which is the right way to connect that LED, I'm going to sit the LED in its correct orientation on top of that heatsink strip and heat up the solder to allow the LED to settle in place. While the solder is warm, you might want to continue doing the rest of the LEDs as well. Make sure to get the orientation correct. Try to heat up both sides of the heatsink strip that goes beneath the LED to make sure it gets a good connection. And be patient. It's sitting on an aluminum PCB, which means it will take time to heat up. And don't grab that PCB when it's hot. Grab yourself a set of pliers so you'd be able to hold it. Once the solder cools, try to move the LED. And if it moves, it's not secured and it needs to be secured better. When you're happy with the results, we're going to add a little bit more flux to the pads because that's what we're going to solder next. Now heat up each pad successively and add some extra solder. When you're done, test each individual LED to make sure it lights up. And you can use the test I talked about earlier. Set your multimeter to the diode test and the LED will light up ever so slightly. Once it's done, let's run the test. Now, in order to test it, I'm going to set our driver to the minimum intensity, which is going to turn on those LEDs at a low intensity. I'm now going to swap these LEDs with this and see what happens. Beautiful. It works. Now I'm going to solder some leads directly to that PCB so they're more secure. When soldering your leads, it helps to tin the wires first. All right, let's plug it in and test it out. Wow. That is bright. It works wonderfully. Might be tough to see on the camera, but these LEDs are illuminating the room like you wouldn't believe. Now that this works really well, I think the next step is to start making some enclosures for our circuitry and our LEDs so we can actually start mounting this somewhere. For that, we'll see you next time.